Hi guys, thank you so much for joining in. Today we have Brother Val from Sacramento joining us, and we're going to hear his testimony. Hello?
Hi.
Thank you very much for coming in.
It's an honor to be here.
Thank you. You can share your testimony and what God did in your life, please.
Yeah, so like a lot of Christians, I grew up in the church, grew up in a Christian family, but at a very young age, I didn't really know what it meant to have a relationship with Jesus. And around 13 years old, I was a very lonely kid. I didn't have much friends. I got into the wrong crowd of people, and I began to drink, I began to smoke, and just got into the world. At first, it started very subtly, and then it moved into where at around age 15, 16, I started selling weed, started doing other drugs, trying different things. And in the back of my mind, I just wanted something that would satisfy, something that would fulfill me. And I didn't really know where to find it. And I knew all about Christianity, or so I thought. And I saw how a lot of Christians were living their lives around me, and it wasn't always the best example. Mm-hmm. And so in my mind, I didn't want to really seek God because I thought it was a boring life. There wasn't anything there for me. And many times I'd actually get into arguments with my mom over it because she saw the way that I was living my life, and she was praying for me constantly. And I remember even this one time where me and my mom got into an argument. I told her to her face, "I will never serve God because of you."
Oh.
And it was one of the most sad things I've ever said, but little did I know that I would actually serve the Lord. And I remember just sitting there at the park one day after I had just gotten into this big argument with my mom, and I said, "God, if you're anything like a lot of these Christians that I'm seeing in my life, I will never serve you." And obviously God ended up proving me wrong, because at around the age of 18, I just saw a lot of my friends going downhill very quickly. A lot of them were getting into heavy drugs. Some of them were getting into prison, just very bad things. And I saw the way that my life was going, and I didn't want to end up like them. And although I wasn't really pursuing God, I didn't really want anything to do with that. I knew that if I didn't stop doing this, I would either end up in jail, I'd end up dead, or on heavy drugs. And so at around age 18, I tried to stop doing all these things. I tried to stop smoking weed, tried to stop drinking alcohol. And as much as I tried, I could not do it. Mm-hmm. I would just get back into the cycle over and over. And I'd always tell my friends, "This is the last time, this is the last time." But I'd always find myself coming back into this place where I'm doing it all over again. But there was just this one day I remember where I got so tired of everything. I just did not like the way I was living my life. And after so many attempts, I knew that I could not do it on my own. And that night I came into my room and I got on my knees and I said, "Jesus, if you're real, help me. If you're out there, if you're watching over me, help me change my life because I can't do it." And I remember a couple days later, I end up coming to a youth service and they did an altar call, and I came up to the front, and that day I surrendered my life to Jesus. I said, "God, you can have my life." The Holy Spirit came upon me and literally set me free. Like, I stopped drinking, I stopped smoking, stopped watching pornography. It was like overnight I became free. And the Bible actually says that who the Son sets free is free indeed.
Amen.
You know, and from that point on, I just, you know, I became a Christian. I was born again. But that's only half of my testimony, because the other half was I thought to myself, okay, I'm a Christian now, I'm going to church, I'm reading my Bible, I'm praying, and I thought that was all there is to Christianity. Mm-hmm. And although I wasn't living in sin, for a while I thought to myself, you know what, I'm a Christian, so all I need to do is become successful now. So I got into a real estate business that I started working on, and for a while I was working on this business, waking up really early in the morning and working late into the evening just to become successful. And for the first couple of months, I remember I was just working, and finally I closed my first deal, and I make more money than I've ever made in my life. And I said, okay, like, this is what I'm going to do. This is my purpose and this is my calling for my life. And I just tried to keep going down this course, and God was always kind of there, but it just became a routine to me, where I would wake up in the mornings, I would pray every morning, I'd read the Bible. It was a discipline more than anything. Mm-hmm. And over time, that's all it became to me. There wasn't really that relationship aspect. In fact, I didn't even know what it truly meant to have a relationship. I just thought, as a Christian, this is what I'm supposed to do, so I'm doing it. And every morning I'd come before God and it was just another check off my list, just so I could go into business, just so I can continue doing my thing. But after a while, about a year and a half into my business, everything started to slow down. A lot of my friends were actually succeeding in the same business as I was, and I was working just as hard. I was doing things that they weren't even trying, and for some reason there was no blessing in what I was doing, and my business just completely slowed down. And I remember sitting there one day in my chair and I'm like, what is the point of all of this? Deep down inside, I felt so empty, and I knew that whatever relationship I had with God before, it wasn't there anymore. And I knew in my heart that I wanted to get closer to God, because I realized there was no point to all of this. And it just like hit me one day. And I said, you know what? I want to get closer to God. And I didn't even know what that would look like. But my mom invited me to come to this prayer. And she'd always have these prayers with her friends at her house, And she'd always invite me, but I was always so busy on those nights. But this time I said, you know what, I'm just going to come because I want to get closer to the Lord. And I end up going to this house. It's about five or six people there that were just praying as they normally do. And we started praying together. And there was this lady there who was a prophet. And she came up to me and she began to prophesy over me. And it was the first time that I can remember that God spoke to me through any form even. And it just seemed like someone who was speaking to me, it just seemed like someone who knew me my whole life was speaking to me in that very moment. And I just completely broke down. The Lord was just revealing so many different things that I've never shared with anyone, let alone this lady who I've never met before in my life. And yet God was speaking so clearly, and He said, my son, I'm calling you to serve me. And that day I encountered the presence of the Lord in such a beautiful way that it changed everything. And I said, Jesus, you can have my dreams, you can have my goals, you can have my business. And I gave everything up to the Lord. And from that day on, nothing was ever the same again. And that was about 4 years ago since I totally gave everything to Jesus. And I can honestly say that it was the best decision I've made in my life.
And praise God. That's so awesome. Something like that actually happened to one of all pastors. Basically, he went to a prayer and there was a prophet there, and he said, oh no, if this lady comes up to me and I just came to church, all my sin list, and this is going to be really bad. And the lady came up to him, and the only thing that she said is, thus says the Lord, I've been waiting for you for so long. And he said that like any rebuke would be better than those words, because he's like, I broke down in front of the Lord just because of those words. Because wow. A lot of times we imagine that God is this evil person that is just waiting just to punish us, and He just can't wait for that moment to punish you. But the Lord, He gave His only Son. Imagine, He can give us so much more, and He loves us so much more. Val, I want you to tell us a little bit. There's so many youth revivals going on, like in Washington, in Portland. Like, I noticed that on this side of America, it's been this amazing thing happening that a lot of youth gathers together. They start praying. Even sometimes pastors are not even involved. They start praying, seeking God's face, and God like sets them free and stuff like that, and they get like Holy Spirit and stuff. Can you share a little bit like that? Like, how did you end up being in all that?
Yeah, so actually about 3 years ago, after I had gotten back from Bible school, I ended up going to Bible school just shortly after I came to the Lord. And then I come back home, and there's this huge revival that's going on. People are gathering together in downtown just to preach the gospel, just to share and talk about the Lord. And for a while, I didn't really know what that would even look like, because I never had that community of people around me that were hungry for Jesus. But right after Bible school, my mission trip, I come to this to my hometown, and yet there was a lot of my friends there, even one of my friends from Bible school, who was just hungry for the Lord. And I was hungry for the Lord. And we just started coming together on Wednesday nights, praying and seeking God. And all these youth would come together in just like homes. People would offer up their homes to to come together and do worship nights, to pray, and it was always so spontaneous. We never really had anything planned because we didn't have much experience at all. We're just, hey, we just want to come to seek the Lord. And so we'd come and we'd worship and we'd pray, and the Lord would always share some kind of word, and we'd see people get touched by God. We'd see people get baptized in the Holy Spirit, get saved, get fired up, and just lots of different things happening out of that. And then in addition to that, we started doing our Sunday night evangelism with United Revival, where we would go out and we would literally just set up a keyboard, a guitar, right in the middle of downtown Sacramento, and we'd start worshiping God. And it was the most beautiful thing, because people that were just walking by would just start coming by and just gathering around us, and it was the perfect opportunity to come up to them and say, hey, do you know about Jesus? Do you know why we're doing this? And many of the people would even ask us, like, hey, what is going on here? So over that period of time, we've seen many, many people come to Christ in downtown, just walking by, going about their day, and yet the Holy Spirit comes upon them through the worship, through someone's obedience coming up to them, and we've just seen people get saved, people get healed, and even delivered, which has been the most amazing thing, because it's all happening through the youth in Sacramento.
Wow, praise God. Honestly, what I think that a lot of times, if we are embarrassed and scared to do something, the next generation after us does it. I'll just share, like recently, I'm from Ohio, and we went and we did like an evangelism, and there was, so I'm passing by one homeless and he was possessed, and I'm like, I'm not going to pray for him. So I pass him by, and then later I find out that there were some teens from like the other church that was participating with us. So they saw the homeless person that he's possessed. They had no experience, so they said that they were scared. So they started praying for him from 15 feet and slowly coming closer and closer and closer. And then they just came up to him and just started praying for deliverance. And for me, it was such a shock. I'm like, Anna, if you don't do something, God is still going to send someone else, and they're still going to do the work. And that's what I actually see right now. That's the teenagers that are just rising up and doing like a lot of things for God. That's awesome.
That's good.
Val, can you share also with us like about social media? That we know that there are a lot of people are being involved in social media right now. How can we touch others? How can we touch souls through it?
Yeah, I think social media is definitely a big platform for ministry and for the Lord to use, because most of the teens of this generation, most of the youth are a lot of times on their phone, even more than they talk to their friends, even more than they talk to their family. Most of their time is on their phone. And so one of the things that God has been showing me is really video content has been huge. And something that the Lord wants to reach out to, because it's very engaging. It's just like being a lot of times in front of that person. And so basically, I've seen video has been huge for ministry, and also blogging as well. A lot of these mediums are actually perfect opportunities for God to reach people that you wouldn't normally see on the streets. Some of these people don't leave their homes. Some of these people are on the other side of the world. And we've seen people be reached through, for example, social media or through like web blogs or YouTube even, all the way in Nigeria, all the way in just different parts of the world where normally you would not be able to get a hold of them. And for me personally, one of the things that the Lord has really been putting on my heart is to do discipleship through video, through posts, through blogs, because I think this generation is really in need of teaching, of good, solid teaching that is involved, that has the truth in it. And so that's one thing that I really see the Lord highlighting, is that He wants to equip the generation at a much faster pace than ever before through social media.
Mm-hmm. Praise God. Yeah, I agree with that too, because like we do small videos and stuff, even like Bible verses. And then like recently we did a video about a man being set free from drugs and how his family was gathered together. And we saw that a Buddhist monk was watching it. I was like, this is crazy. From like Tibet, like some crazy place. And I was watching and I'm like, wow, I don't go there, you know? And it's such a perfect opportunity for us. That's awesome. Praise God. Mm-hmm. Val, also like I wanted to ask you, sometimes I ask that, can you tell us, like I know that you love God, that's why you do all the ministries. If there's someone that does not have that close relationship with God, maybe you can share with them how they can fall in love with God again or first time or something like that.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And this is something, you know, that I come across pretty often, where maybe you have a desire to seek the Lord, or maybe you don't have a desire, but you know that, man, there is no other life than Jesus, but I don't know how I'm supposed to do it. And many Christians have tried to live the good Christian life, right? They've tried to seek God, but many times they end up failing and they're like, I just can't do it. And one of the biggest things that God actually wants to bring us to realization of is that we can't do it on our own. Mm-hmm. If we try to live out the Christian life, if we try to even get the desire to seek Him, it never comes from us. It always comes from God Himself. He's the one that provides the desire. But more than anything, He wants our honest heart before Him. Because we can come and say, God, I've tried. But all He's waiting for is that we're open. You see, the only thing that is preventing God from actually doing what He wants in our lives is our own free will. Because that's something He will never violate. So He's waiting until we get to the opportunity, to that moment where we say, God, I can't do it. Will You do it? Will You give me the desire to read the Bible? Will You give me the desire to pray? Because honestly, I don't have that desire. Can we just be honest before the Lord sometimes? Because mm-hmm. many times we have those same things, same problems where maybe you don't want to read the Bible in that moment. So what do? Do you try to stir yourself up to try to read more of the Bible? Or can you just come before the Lord and be honest and say, Lord, this is what it is. But could You give me the desire? Could You give me the desire to pursue You and seek You? And if we even look at the life of Jesus, everything that Jesus did, it was always by the life of the Father. He never did anything out of Himself, although He could have. Jesus could have lived the Christian life, but He came down as a man, and it says that He humbled Himself. He humbled Himself and He emptied Himself of the privileges of God, of Godhood. And so everything that Jesus did in His life was always dependent on the Father. He said, I don't speak anything unless the Father speaks it. He said, even the works that I do, it's not even me doing it, it's the Father working in me. So there was such a dependency on the Father and on the Holy Spirit that Jesus was constantly dependent on God for everything. And that's why He was able to live out the life that He did. Because He was showing us an example of how we're supposed to live the Christian life. But we have to come to the realization that we can't do this on our own. The harder that we try, the more that we push, we're actually pushing against what He wants to do. The Lord is waiting till we come to a place and say, God, I'm just open to whatever You want. I give You my free will. Would You have Your way in my life? Would You give me the desire? Because on my own, I can't stir up that desire, even if I tried, you know?
Yeah. I have another question also. You know, sometimes there are a lot of like younger guys who say, well, I'll serve God whenever I'll be like 50, 40. Let me just do whatever I want to do. Can you speak to them that whatever you tasted in God, it was worth and much more than in this world?
Yeah, and actually I had that same mindset when I was young and I was living in the world, because I thought that Christianity couldn't satisfy. It was a boring life, mm-hmm. or so I thought. And that's exactly what the Lord began to really show me, is that there is no better life than a life in Jesus. And you see, if you think about it, everything that we do in this life, we're all searching for a feeling, right? The reason why you get a nice car, because you like the way it makes you feel. Mm-hmm. The reason why you get a good job, you want to feel secure. It always comes down to a sense of, I want to be satisfied. Mm-hmm. And I'm looking for something to satisfy me. Mm-hmm. So what we do is we're actually pursuing certain things, thinking that once I get here, I'll finally be happy. I'll finally be satisfied with my life. Mm-hmm. But the Bible actually says in Psalm 16:11 that in His presence is fullness of joy, and at His right hand are pleasures forevermore. That means that only in His presence can we find true joy, can we find true peace, and everything that can truly satisfy us, it's only found in God. Because you see, the one that has created us, He knows how to satisfy us better than anyone else. So what we do is we end up running from thing to thing, trying to find that sense of satisfaction, but when we get there, we realize, oh no, I have to go to the next thing, and there's never truly any real fulfillment. There might be short temporary happiness, but there isn't true satisfaction in this life without Jesus. And when you come to know who Jesus is, you actually taste of something that is so much greater and so much better, so much more fulfilling, that isn't dependent on a circumstance. It's not about getting somewhere, but it's what you already have in Christ. And that's the beauty of it, is that in any situation, in any moment, you can have joy, you can have peace, because Christ lives in you and you know Him. And just in His presence, there is greater joy than in anything else that this world can offer you. And I always say this, because I've experienced this personally, is that even in my highest moments in sin weren't even as close to as good as my lowest points with God.
Amen.
Because even in the lowest moments, I could still have joy in Jesus. But in my highest moments in sin, you're still empty inside and you know it. You know?
I always like God, when I talk to some girls at the rehab centers and stuff, I'm like, okay, what exactly do you miss? Which point? When you go to a party and everyone is like two-faced and then you drink to no point and you wake up and throw up, like which point do you really miss? Because in the end of the day, it does not bring satisfaction, as you said, that only God can fulfill us, and He can give us so much more blessings, like true families, like true real friends who are normal, who actually want good for you and not just saying bad things about you behind your back. Val, also you mentioned before we started the interview that you do some man groups and things like that. What if there's some, like a guy who's successful, who has a job, loves the Lord, but he does not know what is his calling in life? Like, you know, so can you give an advice, maybe, if a person, a successful guy, is watching us and he doesn't know his calling, how to find that calling? Because it's okay to work and stuff like that, obviously.
Yeah, no, that's on point. And I would say you find the calling when you find Him. Mm-hmm. The calling comes to you when you start looking for Jesus. And everything that I have ever received in this life, in terms of ministry, in terms of serving, even my work, it has all come from God and seeking Him. It says in Matthew 6:33 that when you seek first the kingdom of God, everything will be added to you. Everything else will be added. And that's because in Him we have all the promises, and our calling is only in finding Him. But you see, what the Lord often wants to do is for us to come to know Him first, because He wants to develop our character. He wants to develop our thinking, change our mindset, because of a lot of the things that we've believed. He wants to totally uproot a lot of those things and replace it with just an understanding of who He is. And then you begin to step into the things that He's calling you into. You see, the work has to happen on yourself first a lot of times. Before He begins to send you out, He wants to conform you into the image of His Son, Jesus. You see, because God wants Jesus through your life. He doesn't just want you trying to do something for Him. He wants the very life of Christ operating through you. And I would say one of the more practical ways is really to have a community of believers around you. It's one thing is that, you know, you can go about this Christian life trying to do things on your own, but without the body of Christ, it's very difficult. It's very difficult to do anything when there isn't believers around you that love Jesus, that are pursuing Him, and that there are those that can actually edify you and build you up, and you can build them up, vice versa. Because that community aspect is what enables us to even grow, because there's two parts of Jesus, right? There's Jesus in us, but there's also Jesus in other people. Mm-hmm. And God wants to reveal Himself through other people, in those other people, to you. Mm-hmm. So that community aspect is very important for guys that are looking to even find their calling. Is I would say start looking for the Lord first before anything else. Find satisfaction in Him, and the calling is going to come. And more than anything, the Lord is going to bring you into a community of believers that actually love Him, that are seeking Him, that will enable you to walk in just a greater measure of authority, a greater measure of even your understanding, because you will get to see different parts of the body of Christ, not just your own perspective, but the perspective of others as well.
Also, I wanted to add, like, if someone wants to become a pastor or like a spiritual father or a leader, it does not happen overnight. So God will show you like a one hurting person. You go comfort them and you kind of like learn. And from that experience, it just, you become stronger and stronger and stronger. And I personally believe that it's not like it doesn't happen overnight that, oh, okay, you become this amazing preacher. Like you wake up and you're there already. Mm. It's just like certain steps that you need to take. And that's how God leads you. Well, also, we are coming to the end, and Thank you so much for being here. And I wanted you to pray for someone and tell the gospel. If there's someone watching us that never heard about Jesus Christ, and if you can tell them the gospel and pray for them, that would be great.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's the most amazing thing, everyone who's watching, is that God came to this earth as a man. You see, if he came down as God, we would have an excuse to say, well, Jesus came down and he used his God-given abilities to do everything he did on earth. But Jesus came as a man and humbled himself. And he came down to this earth for each and every one of us. Why? Because we couldn't do it on our own. The Bible says that we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We've all made mistakes. We've all done wrong. And that's exactly the reason why we've even been disconnected from our relationship with God, is because of our sin. But when Jesus came down to this earth, he lived a perfect and sinless life for each and every one of us, so that when we put our trust in him, we actually have access to everything he's done. And that is, he actually came to this earth and he died on that cross. He was buried and he rose on the third day so that we can have life, so that we can have the restoration in our relationship with God, and so that all our sins could be paid for. And that's exactly what Jesus is offering you today. It's not just another service. It's not just another church service. It's not religion. He's asking for a relationship with you. You know, Jesus is coming back for his bride. He's coming back for those who he loves and those who are seeking after him. And let me tell you, my friend, that God has something so much more in store for you than just one Sunday service or maybe just living a life of defeat. But God is waiting for the moment where you just say, you know what, Lord, I'm open. I may not understand everything that is going on. I may not understand how this all works, but Lord, would you show yourself to me? And God is going to show himself to you. He's going to reveal himself to you and show you who he is. And that's when everything changes. When you have a real encounter with Jesus. I went to church my whole life and I didn't have an encounter with Jesus until I was 18. And that's what changed me. You see, religion doesn't change people. Going to a church service doesn't change people. Jesus himself is what changes you. So I just want to encourage you, if you're out there today, the Bible says that if we turn away from our sin, if we put our trust in Jesus, we can have eternal life. But if you're out there and you've already put your trust in Jesus and you said, I've tried to live the good Christian life, I've tried to live in victory, but I can't. Come before the Lord right now and just say, Jesus, I'm open to what you want to do in my life. I'm open for you to come in and show me who you are. And if you haven't received Jesus, just say, Jesus, I want you in my life. Would you come in? It says that he's knocking at the door of your heart. If you let him in, he will come in and dine with you. So just be open to what Jesus wants and say, Lord, whatever you want to do in my life, I give you permission to. And God is going to change your life. He's going to reveal himself to you. And it's going to change everything.
Amen. If you can please say a prayer as well.
Yeah. So Father, I just bless every single person that is watching online right now. And Lord, I pray that you would encounter them right now, Holy Spirit, just as they're open, Lord, for all those who are watching and they're maybe saying, Lord, I don't know if I could do this. Lord, would you show them right now the victory that we have in Jesus, the finished work of the cross, Lord. I just pray for a greater understanding of the work of Jesus Christ in their lives, Lord. And I pray for all those that have never received you, Lord, that they would just encounter your presence right now, that you would come into their room, their car, wherever they are, Lord. Touch them, Holy Spirit, right now. Touch them and change them, Lord. And Father, as we are open to receiving from you right now, I just pray for fresh vision, fresh downloads from you, Lord. Would you just reveal yourself in a greater measure, Lord, that we would see your heart, that we would see your love, and we would come to know you in a greater way, Father. I bless each and every person online, Lord. I also just proclaim healing over those who are sick, that are just in need of any healing right now, Father, whether it's a spiritual healing, a physical healing, a emotional healing, a soul healing, Father, I just proclaim healing over every person watching online in the name of Jesus, Lord, and that everyone who is captive, that is bound by the enemy, Lord, I just break every chain and I proclaim freedom in their lives in the name of Jesus, Lord. Thank you that who you set free is free indeed, Lord. So I just proclaim freedom, healing, restoration, and salvation over every person watching right now. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. Thank you so much for watching us. May God bless you and your homes. Bye-bye.